Hello, and welcome to Insights Live. What's the latest on the markets? I'm Jim Armstrong, and I work in the educational webinar space here at Fidelity. Now, typically, I'm focused on digital assets education, but today we're going to be taking a deep dive into the overall current state of our economy. We'll talk about the markets, and we'll talk about what it all means for your portfolio. First, wanted to start by thanking you for your time, taking time out of your day to be with us for this conversation, and a special thanks to everybody who submitted questions when they registered. Those questions really go a long way in helping us shape today's discussion. Before we get going, I do want to mention that Fidelity does not give legal or tax advice, so nothing we talk about today should be interpreted as legal or tax advice. The information we share is really going to be general in nature, and probably not going to apply to your situation. If you do have any legal or tax questions about your specific situation, we would just encourage you to talk to your attorney or to a tax professional. Okay, with that out of the way, let's move on to the meat of our conversation today. We'll start off by introducing our three excellent panelists. It would be great, I think, actually, if each of you could just spend a minute or so introducing yourselves, giving a little bit of your background, and talk about the perspective that you'll bring to today's conversation. And Chris, we'll start with you if that's okay.
That's great. Thanks, Jim. My name is Chris Dodd. My role here at Fidelity is as a vice president, financial consultant in Fidelity's wealth group. I'm an advisor based in Houston, but work with clients all across the country. I'm actually coming to you today from Seattle, moving my son up here who just graduated college. I've been at Fidelity for almost 25 years as a certified financial planner, certified equity professional, and prior to and during my time with Fidelity, an analyst in the United States Air Force. What I'll be talking about today, common themes. You know, clients come to me every day about their concerns on their own family situations, future planning, all the topics we'll be discussing here today. So that's just kind of a general overview. But Hannah, you know, what about yourself? Tell us about yourself and your role here at Fidelity.
Sure. Thanks, Chris. My name's Hannah Kamas, and I'm an institutional portfolio manager within Strategic Advisors. I'm based in Boston. Prior to joining Fidelity 5 years ago, I was a portfolio manager, and I spent the better part of 20 years focusing on asset allocation, multi-asset class portfolio construction, and manager research for both public and private pools of capital, which included managing the assets of a large public pension plan for the better part of 13 years or so. And today I'll be sharing just a little bit about how we think about the markets, the economy, and how we're positioning client portfolios. Christine, want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Well, hi, everyone. My name is Christine Thorpe. I'm an institutional portfolio manager within Fidelity's fixed income division. So I've actually been here at the firm for about 13 years. And really, as a member of the investment team, I'm doing exactly what we're going to be talking about today. So I share, you know, our insights with our fixed income managed account clients about, you know, what's going on in the markets, what's our outlook for fixed income, and how we're positioning portfolios.
Excellent. This really is a great group. I'm psyched to be able to spend the next 40 minutes or so with you picking your brains and getting our customers' questions answered. So let's start with some great, if not contradictory, news, right? The latest data, the reports that we keep seeing show the U.S. economy is really quite strong. I mean, inflation is leveling out. The job market is robust. Markets in general have been hitting all-time highs. And at the same time, we're also seeing reports about customer sentiment being kind of soft. People aren't really, I guess, as happy with the economy as the other polls' results would have us think they maybe could or should be. So, Hannah, I'd love your take on what customer sentiment and how it matters when you're trying to evaluate the health of the economy as a whole right now.
Yeah, sure, Chris. I mean, you're right. There has been a lot of noise out there. It's likely causing some confusion. So in fact, when we look at a recent Harris Guardian poll, it shows that 56% of Americans believe the U.S. is in a recession. We're not. Nearly half believe stocks are down for the year. They aren't. And that unemployment is at a 50-year high. So absolutely not true. So how people feel and what's actually happening in the economy don't always correlate. Because while the economy and markets aren't the same from cycle to cycle, they do generally rhyme. And by analyzing key indicators such as corporate earnings and jobs, we get a better understanding of the larger economic picture. Are we in early cycle, mid-cycle, late cycle, recession? And as we look at it, our analysis and insights continue to support that we are squarely in late cycle. In late cycle, inflation and interest rates can move higher, This can also lead to higher prices for consumer goods. Stock market may experience more volatility, and this can be due to uncertainty around U.S. corporate profits and economic growth. All of this likely feels familiar, right? And that's because it's typical late cycle. And as our colleagues on our asset allocation research team remind us, late cycle is not pre-recession. Economies often expand and grow in late cycle, as we've experienced, catalyzed by the likes of a strong employment picture and corporate profitability.
Chris, you mentioned right off the top how you're talking with customers and clients essentially every day. I'd love to get your perspective on what the average investor is worried about these days. What's on people's minds?
Yeah, well, a lot, right? I think news of the day does tend to drive a lot of the conversations I'm having with clients, and timely, right? The Fed, you know, just met yesterday. We'll talk more about that, but policy outlook, interest rates, you know, politics, we'll talk through all of that. You know, and over the last year and a half, you know, these all-time highs, are we going to have a pullback? You know, the growth in technology, AI stocks, you know, real estate, interest rates, all of those are topics that we talk through almost on a daily basis. But I try to, you know, refocus on long-term, you know, what are your goals? You know, we can focus on short-term politics, short-term interest rates, but really how does that play into what is going to impact you and your family over the lifetime of yourself, your, you know, your kids and grandkids, hopefully. So control what's, you know, in your purview out there, a lot of things we just can't control. Short-term interest rates though are, you know, at 5%. It's been over a decade that we haven't seen interest rates above zero. So I think range of 5% does help out some short-term kind of parking it in cash. But when the Fed does start lowering interest rates, what do you do next? Do you take action ahead of time? Do you do something after the fact? But it does provide some, you know, investment opportunities. Long-term bonds or bond funds, they're paying some higher rates than they have been in the past. We're noticing them start to come down a little bit. And I know Christine will talk more on that on interest rates, but, you know, income ratios on annuities, pensions, you know, they're providing more of an income stream for folks that haven't been able to get that in the past out there. But I do think, you know, psychology does play a lot into it. We haven't had interest rates be this high for 10, 15 years. So I think of the subset of clients that I'm working with, whether they're, you know, 40 to 90 years old, they remember when interest rates were high in the 80s and 90s, but where are they at today? Well, they're about normal. So I think it's just resetting the bar a little bit and remembering this is not abnormal. It's just different from, you know, where it's been in the past. The bigger challenge, I mentioned my son, you know, just graduating college, but 20 to 40 year olds haven't seen interest rates above zero ever, right? Or very, very low. So when you're talking about mortgages or renting or car notes, or should you get a credit card, all of those topics are coming up. But I think I bring it back to the basics is historically, we're actually in a pretty average interest rate environment.
All right, Christine, that is the perfect segue to you as a bond manager. I know you, like a lot of people watching right now, follow interest rates really closely. What's your sense of when we might be able to expect an interest rate cut?
Yeah, certainly. And, you know, it's clearly no surprise, you know, and particularly just given what Chris said, that, you know, this really is top of mind for bond investors. You know, everyone is glued to the Fed and wants to know, right, what are we going to see from them moving forward? I'd say, you know, the theme so far this year has been, you know, just the market continuing to dial back its expectations around really the timing and magnitude of cuts that we might see this year. I'd also say I think that's pretty appropriate, right? Just given the resilience of the U.S. economy that Hannah certainly alluded to at the start. I would categorize the Fed as really, you know, continuing to be data dependent here. You know, I don't think they need to wait for inflation to get all the way down to their target of 2% before they start to cut. But, you know, as Chairman Powell for the Fed shared just this week at the June meeting, you know, they do likely need conviction that inflation's on that right trajectory of, you know, continuing to fall before they start to implement cuts. And, you know, at least that's going to be, I think, their view while the labor market and the broader economy remain somewhat healthy. You know, I don't think they want to give up, right, all the gains that they've achieved. And they can afford to be patient, just given that sort of broad macro landscape. And so if we continue on this path, you know, perhaps we see the Fed cut 1 to 2 times by year end. But, you know, the flip side is, right, they've got the ability to be flexible. And so they can be aggressive with cutting if they need. So if we get some type of growth scare or geopolitical event that really moves markets, right, those are the types of events where they could pivot from their current thinking.
So thank you for that. Let's spend a few minutes talking about moving from that macro lens over which we as individual investors have absolutely no control to the micro. So what are the conditions you just described mean to bond investors today?
Yeah, Jim, you're right. That's the natural next question. You know, I would say just broadly, our perspective is we believe bonds continue to be an attractive asset class. So, you know, when you think about yields, again, Chris spoke about this, right? They're significantly higher, you know, than what we've seen really over the last two decades. And that's why we think bonds, you know, continue to be compelling when you look at them for income potential. Now, while we've seen some rate volatility over the course of this year, you know, rates have remained consistently elevated. So the 10-year U.S. Treasury remains above 4%. And even real rates, right, or the yield you earn after inflation is close to 2%. And really, you know, you'd have to go back to the global financial crisis or GFC for rates that attractive. Now, at the same time, you know, bonds offer some pretty attractive or compelling total return opportunities. So you got to remember, right, total return and fixed income is going to be that combination of yield and price changes. And so that higher yield that we now have back in fixed income can really, you know, help offset price volatility if we were to see a scenario where rates were to move higher. And if rates move lower, right, the reverse is also true, where it could potentially lead to some increases in bond prices, and you'd be able to couple that with the higher yield we're earning today. Now, I'd also expect that the diversification benefits of investing in fixed income could return if the Fed becomes less a driver of volatility in the market. Now, with all of that said, I do think it's important for investors just to think about, right, where they're investing in the curve or which maturities they're utilizing. Now, if the Fed has to cut aggressively, we'd expect those front end rates could really fall quickly. So you're subject to a lot of reinvestment risk and, you know, potentially could miss out on earning some higher yields for longer. But of course, you know, you got to remember that as you move out the curve or you move to bonds with longer maturities, right, they typically have more volatility in price swings. So that just means, you know, you got more upside potential, but more downside risk as well. And I think that all comes back to, right, why, you know, time horizon and risk tolerance are really important considerations when you're trying to balance all those factors.
And in anticipation of the Fed cutting rates, Chris, I've got to imagine you're getting this question almost every day, if not more commonly than that. What do I do with my strategy? How does my portfolio adapt? How do I anticipate that change? What's the answer to that question?
Yeah, it's a tough one. I think like I mentioned earlier, short-term versus long-term needs. Bonds, to me, do, you know, fit into your portfolio as a stabilizer. And I think the challenge over the last year or two, you know, 2022 was a bad year in the stock market. Interest rates started to rise, and we got kind of this double whammy where stocks and bonds were both down. But now, you know, the last year and a half, mainly with technology and artificial intelligence, through the roof. So when clients look at a bond portfolio and say, hey, why am I getting flat returns or negative returns in a short period? It's just trying to remind folks, look, as time goes on out there and interest rates do go down, it's that inverted relationship. And I think that's a tough concept for a lot of folks to remember, that bonds are a stabilizer. They're not meant to be a growing part of your portfolio. They're meant to be a dividend spinoff. Maybe you get some price gains out there, but the goal is to minimize the volatility of all that stock that is going up and down out there. But that being said, the alternatives right now with cash being at 5%, you know, I've got a lot of clients that are just sitting in cash, just waiting. And I think the challenge with waiting, you miss out on some of those good times in the market. And as we look through, you know, what does that mean on your portfolio? We tend to see that you miss out on just 5 days, 10 days, 30 days in the market. It can make a dramatic change in your portfolio. So if rates do start coming down, you know, do we start buying longer term CDs, bond or bond funds with longer durations, or fixed annuities, you know, something that can be bond-like, but they lock in a certain rate, maybe for a longer period of time out there. But, you know, waiting for rates to come down, that's the challenge, right? Is the doing it after rates come down, you've missed the boat. Yeah. So taking some action, maybe not right at the optimal level, but you're locking in something that you're comfortable with. You may not time it perfectly, but that's okay. And I think time in the market is sometimes better than timing the market. So take action, you know, have a plan, and we'll talk more about that.
Absolutely. And so to set context a little bit, here we are in this long bull market combined with relatively high inflation and relatively high interest rates. And I know we saw this theme come up in a lot of questions that registrants for the webinar sent in, this concern that things have been too good for too long. Things are going too well. How long can it be sustained? So Hannah, how would you answer that question? This sense of like, ooh, can this really keep going?
Yeah, I mean, we get this question a lot. And as we often say on our team, market cycles don't die of old age. And as I just touched on, as long as people remain employed and companies continue to grow their earnings, just as examples, economic growth can persist, which in turn can contribute to positive market performance. And we've seen continued strength in both of these areas, jobs and earnings. So let's touch on jobs, right? The US job market has mostly exceeded expectations in 2024. We saw the May non-farm payroll release highlighting 272,000 jobs added. This was well ahead of what economists had projected. So even though we've seen some splashy headlines with some high-profile tech companies announcing layoffs, job force reduction is really pretty low. And if I just put a little bit of precision on that point, the Labor Department reported that the total number of workers laid off from their jobs in March came in to a seasonally adjusted 1.5 million people and held that level again in April. And that was the fewest since December 2022 and approximately 300,000 less than pre-pandemic 2019. And that was arguably a pretty good job for year for the job market, if you think back to those times. So if you roll all of this together, we still have an unemployment rate that remains near multi-decade lows. And while it has ticked up incrementally, as you may have seen, it's still well below the long-term average of 5.8%. And so we still haven't really seen widespread stress in the job market. And if we turn to earnings just for a minute, you know, the majority of US companies have now reported earnings results that indicate profit growth is still on the upswing. In fact, earnings per share for companies in the S&P 500, which is really a bellwether indicator for US stocks, are up about 5.9% from a year earlier. And this is, again, well ahead of analyst expectations at the end of the first quarter. So all in all, this is shaping up to be the strongest earnings growth in nearly 2 years. And strength in US corporate profitability is generally a good indicator of continued expansion.
So given all of that background, plus what we've already talked about in terms of where we are in the market cycle, I'd love to have you respond to another theme that popped up in the questions we received. What might investors consider doing with cash on the sidelines right now? Would it be smart for them? Would it make sense to wait to buy until prices come down?
Yeah, the short answer is no. But if, you know, if we look at what's happened, stocks had another strong month in May. U.S. stocks were up about 5%. That punctuated a really pretty remarkable year thus far for stocks. And so if we think about what happened in the first quarter, and we'll just use the first quarter as an example of market behavior, in the first 3 months of the year, the S&P 500 rose more than 10% and reached a new all-time high 22 times in one quarter. So this example, in combination with stock market performance since the end of March, are likely a relief to many, especially considering that most folks expected a recession in 2023. But there's probably still a subset of people that view all of those all-time highs as a sign that the market's peaking and are likely questioning the probability of a decline on the horizon. So let's look at a chart to maybe help bring this to life. Just to orient the audience to the slide, you see the orange line on the chart shows cumulative monthly stock returns, and the blue lines represent the all-time highs that occurred during the period from 1950 through 2023. And at Strategic Advisors, we're students of history. So stocks have tended to continue to further rise after reaching all-time highs, as you can see on the slide, and sell-offs actually being a bit unusual. And since 1950, in the years following all-time highs, the average total return for the S&P 500 index was about 12.7%. So if an investor took an all-time high as a sign that it's time to get out of the market, or to a shift to a more conservative asset allocation, they probably would have missed out on further significant gains in the stock market.
And Chris, so same question to you. How do you answer that question when you're sitting across from or on a call with a client who asks whether or not it makes sense to buy stocks when the market's so high?
Yeah, much like Hannah said, Jim, I think we look to those slides and we'll show up another one here about long-term view versus short-term view, right? Yeah. The market's at an all-time high. I'll wait till it corrects. Well, what happens if the market goes up another 30% like the last 18 months and it hasn't really come down substantially? We'll have little dips, maybe the April timeframe and sometimes last year. But I think, did you take action or not? Or was that fear, you know, waiting for the next shoe to drop and it go down 20%? I'll wait until that point comes. But the challenge really is taking action. It's the psychology. I keep going back to that all the time is it's fear. It really is. But if you're looking at it from a long-term view, much like Hannah said, long-term, the market averages, you know, 10, 12% after reaching those all-time highs out there. So a gradual investment plan, I think of 401k investing, you know, coming out of your paycheck, it just automatically happens. Doing the same thing with maybe cash sitting in the bank or savings accounts or just money markets is I'm waiting for that pullback. Well, maybe not wait till the pullback. Let's just set up an automatic investment plan. But I mentioned it before, too, that the missing the 10 best days in the market, you know, the slide we'll bring up here and kind of talk through that is those are substantial paper losses, right? It's real losses if you're not invested. So try to take the guesswork out of it. Try not to let the anxiety, you know, get in too much, but have a plan. Talk to your advisor, you know, just come up with a game plan and don't just wait. I think that's where I see it's a feel good factor, but it's kind of the easy way out.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, quick follow up with you, Chris, on this idea of cash. You've mentioned that higher interest rates might present an opportunity for some investors, but they also represent more expensive borrowing costs, and they've certainly impacted mortgage rates. So I'm curious what you think about when you get the question, you know, should people try to avoid taking a mortgage now, for example, either by renting, continuing to rent, or if they have the option, paying for a house in cash? I know those circumstances for each individual person really matters, but in general, how would you answer a question like that?
Yeah, it's tough. You know, every situation is so unique out there. Where is somebody in their life cycle of retirement, of earnings, starting off, right? There may not be a consistent income stream anymore if you're retired. Maybe it's Social Security, but if you don't have a pension or an annuity, you've got to be drawing off of your portfolio, and banks and underwriters want to see a consistent cash flow to support a mortgage. So it's a challenge. It can be done, but you've got to, you know, kind of be smart about it. Those that do just use cash sitting in the bank, I think it's, again, a feel-good factor not to have that monthly mortgage payment. But if you use all of your cash that's available in non-retirement accounts, yeah, now every time you're pulling money out of an account, you're paying income tax, federal and state, if you're subject to that. And sometimes that's worse than paying a 5 or 6% interest rate. So rates being all-time highs, or not all-time, but they're too high right now, I go back to what I mentioned earlier, is historically, mortgage rates are pretty average out there right now. So I think talking through that with the client and their situation, on the younger generation side, I mentioned that earlier, it's affordability, right? You may not be able to afford rent on your own. You may need to get a roommate. And I know a lot of parents and grandparents are trying to help their kids and grandkids with that, but it's setting the foundation. I'm just saying, hey, maybe you can't afford to finance it right now. Let's just rent to get started. But it's also use, right? A lot of folks buying a second home, could they do it? Yes. But then the carrying costs, the taxes, you know, sometimes renting a long-term rental, we see a lot of clients doing long-term, you know, long-term rentals for a summer, 2, 3, 4 months at a time, versus paying for a new house and all the costs that go along with that. So those are just a few things we talk about. But if you don't have access to, you know, your own funds or eligibility, if you've got a house, maybe it's a line of credit. Sometimes it's an inheritance coming from another family member. And there are new rules with, you know, inheriting retirement accounts. Very complicated. You know, talk to one of us as an advisor and we talk through that. But that can come into play with generational wealth planning.
Let's pivot now from the micro back up to the macro and talk about something else that we get a lot of questions about. That's a big, big topic. So, Christine, I hope you're ready for it. The national debt, right? It's recently reached an all-time high, unfortunately, relative to the GDP, to the gross domestic product. But if you could start us off by just spending a minute or two level setting, unpacking this a little bit, why has U.S. debt been rising and why are people concerned about it?
Yeah, Jim, those are big questions, but you know, this is in the headlines, right? So we know, you know, everyone has those same questions. I think just to level set, right, that the national debt is the total amount of debt that the federal government has accumulated. And the reason for that is we've been running, right, these annual deficits. So just meaning, you know, the government spent more than it's taken in, and therefore, you know, the total outstanding debt has continued to grow, and it's continued to grow at a really significant pace. You know, even just in the last 10 years, the federal debt has just about doubled. You know, perhaps not a surprise given the extent of fiscal stimulus that was laid out in the wake of the global pandemic, but certainly still a concerning rate. Now, the federal government can finance this debt in ways that you and I cannot. So that's just to say, right, they can issue treasuries to help cover the gaps that are left unfilled by federal revenues. Of course, most of those revenues are taxes, which we're all familiar with. Now, the coupons on those treasuries are the interest cost. And, you know, this interest cost really wasn't as big of a factor, you know, when rates were really low, but certainly more of a consideration now just in this higher rate environment. So, you know, treasury yields, of course, have moved higher as the Fed has tightened monetary policy. And really, it's this higher interest expense that causes many, you know, to question just how sustainable our fiscal outlook is if we continue to run, you know, these really massive deficits from year to year. So it's not only is our interest cost increasing, but right, the amount we need to finance is increasing as well. So to solve this, you know, no easy solutions, right? We can either reduce spending, increase taxes, or implement some combination of the two. You know, neither tend to be popular politically. Again, not surprising. So, you know, hard to see those as two, you know, really potential paths forward. Of course, you know, another scenario is we can grow our way out of it. So we'll be watching factors like AI, right, just to see what impact that has on the broader economy and our growth potential. You know, I would say that I do think the debt issue is more, most likely more of a long-term issue and not one that's new, right? It's been around for quite some time now. And I think it's also important for clients to understand that, you know, U.S. Treasuries remain, you know, really the most liquid part of the bond market. As a fixed income manager, they're really a key part of how we manage the overall interest rate sensitivity of our clients' portfolios. And it's a sector we're going to continue to invest in. It's frankly too large for us not to.
Hannah, what's your sense of what the national debt means to us as investors?
Yeah, well, maybe let's just calibrate first, right? Because this high debt to GDP issue is not a uniquely American one. Mm-hmm. In fact, the overall level of government debt to GDP in the US is actually in line with many other developed market counterparts. So you've got Canada and France and Germany and the UK as examples, all sort of in the same zone. And this national debt has been rising for several decades across multiple administrations and political configurations, as Christine sort of alluded to. So that said, it's still not great. Certainly doesn't feel good. Don't want to minimize that. But, you know, just to expand on Christine's comments a little bit further, based on government projections, the deficit outlook for fiscal year 24 is relatively neutral in terms of its impact on economic growth. And longer term, the rising national debt could lead to things like higher taxes and spending cuts, which could impact the markets and has the potential to be a drag on economic growth. Politically, spending cuts have become difficult as mandatory outlays on entitlement programs assume a larger and larger share of fiscal expenses. So if we think about the FY24 budget, mandatory entitlements, so think Medicare, Social Security, make up 60% of the budget. Defense, which makes up another 13%, is likely not going to be cut either, especially in the current geopolitical environment. So it really doesn't leave much room for spending cuts, which likely results in taxation being one of the only avenues for alleviation. So if you boil all this down, really, investors that are worried about the implications of increased national debt on their portfolios could likely benefit from diversification, which is what the investment team at Strategic Advisors amplifies in our client portfolios, right? Extending beyond U.S. stocks by incorporating the likes of international stocks, bonds, commodities, and alternatives?
Probably a group of questions we got even more than those related to the national debt were those about this being an election year. No one watching right now needs to be reminded that this is a presidential election year, several months left to go before the election itself in November. I know that we're already getting questions from investors. What does the election mean? What do I need to be doing to my portfolio if X or Y happens? Lots of concern over how people should be planning for or pre-reacting to the 2024 presidential election. So Hannah, I'd love it if both you and Chris could give us your take on those questions.
Sure. I mean, you hit the nail right on the head. Election years leave a lot of people with a lot of angst about market performance, who may or may not win. So let's maybe just diffuse things a bit by starting out with just a couple little fun facts. You know, the U.S. is not the only country having an election this year. 64 countries have major elections this year, and those countries represent about 50% of the global population, or about 4 billion people. And this is not the first presidential rematch. There have been six other instances, the most recent being 1956. We saw Eisenhower defeat Adlai Stevenson. So, you know, as we think about it, we focus on policy and not politics. Why is that? Well, policy is tangible, whereas politics, as we all know, tends to be really emotional. And when you think about policy, it can often take months or even years, candidly, to roll into the system. That said, we don't recommend making anticipatory moves to your portfolios, as policy outcomes can often differ greatly from what's touted on the campaign trail, right? Rhetoric doesn't always translate into implemented policy. So tax implications, the possibility of tariffs certainly matter, but through our investment lens, we think it's also important to understand the shape of the political system and how it can impact corporate earnings and the likes.
Yeah, thanks, Hannah. Hey, I'll take the next one here. I mean, just talking about the slide that's up on the screen now is, you know, one of the questions I always get is, well, who gets elected? Is that going to be good or bad? Well, again, politics aside, the policy is going to drive that. And the performance of the market in election years and over a four-year election cycle, they can vary, but historically, they're about even. And on the positive side, whether it's a Democrat or Republican, you know, at the charge. So, you know, over that time frame, you're going to have some volatility. There's going to be news of the day. There's going to be some policy, you know, rhetoric, like Hannah said, that comes out. But does it actually get passed, or is it the fear factor that comes into play? So I guess we'll have to wait and see how November 5th plays out before we know for sure. But I think overall, no action is better than taking, you know, fear action out there. So I would say just kind of sit tight, and numbers show that the market does pretty well regardless of who's at the top.
And taking that deep breath, as you both mentioned, and not trying to be overruled by headlines of the day certainly is good advice, but can be difficult to take in the midst of everything. So totally appreciate that. But Chris, there is just a tremendous amount of uncertainty right now. And I think we've talked about it several times already today. How do you help clients manage that uncertainty when they're dealing with something as tangible as their finances?
Yeah, it's a tough one. I think my job is twofold, sometimes as a financial advisor, sometimes as a therapist, right? It's just talking through the family dynamics. What's your risk tolerance, your financial situation, your emotional situation? You know, do you have a good reserve or not? You know, emergency funds that are out there? Mm-hmm. Do you have a guaranteed income stream? I mentioned Social Security is one, but pensions or, you know, some sort of stream that's coming in, but also the growth side. And sometimes I'll see people really good on one of those three, but maybe not so good on the other two. So it's just reassessing your risk profile. You know, as you age or as your life changes, you may change. You may need more assets. You may have, you know, less assets because you're supporting a family member. You've got an aging parent that may need nursing home care or kids in college, right? So keeping emergency funds aside, I think the key that I share with everybody is try to keep at least 6 to 12 months worth of living expenses, sometimes more, sometimes less. I have some folks that keep 3 years worth of living expenses. because they're fearful of a job change, right? A layoff, a health scare, a family member gets diagnosed with something that's going to devote more time toward that. But moving costs, I can speak for that. You know, the last 5 days driving from Texas to Seattle, you know, I paid $2.70 a gas in Texas, and I'm paying $4.90 here in Seattle. So moving costs, you know, location can play a factor in there as well. And that goes back to a current job versus taking on a new job is, can you afford to do that? And again, in retirement, it's a lot tougher because the paycheck technically isn't there. You may need to create your own paycheck. And that's what we're just talking folks through. So it's always reevaluating, confirming the expenses. What's the plan? What's the wild card item that, you know, you may not think about? I try to bring up client stories or my own personal stories with clients, but it's just really assessing risk versus reward. Do you want more, you know, dividend paying stocks or growth stocks? What's more important to you?
Excellent. Excellent. And as we start to begin to wrap up here, let's talk about some opportunities, right? Let's maybe, Christine, start with you when we talk about fixed income. How are you positioning portfolios that your team manages when it comes to fixed income?
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, I would just say, given the backdrop of everything we've talked about, you know, volatility, the rate environment, you know, the broader economic health, you know, we are just continuing to be patient. That's probably the theme I would hit upon if I had to describe how we're positioning portfolios. You know, and sometimes being patient, right? It's really hard to do as an investor. Within our taxable strategy, you know, we continue to have an allocation to investment grade corporate bonds. You know, we feel like we've got a real investment edge when, you know, we're trying to source great ideas from our broad research team, particularly when we go down in credit quality and we see just more dispersion in how different issuers and issues are priced. And corporate bonds, you know, continue to be really an important source of additional yield in our client portfolios. But at this point in the cycle, we're not adding to corporate bonds significantly. You know, we look at investment grade corporate spreads or valuations, they're pretty high. So just means, right, they're more expensive compared to the last two decades. And I think, again, that makes sense, right, given, you know, corporate balance sheets that are in decent shape and, you know, we're seeing really healthy demand for credit from investors. But with that backdrop, it's just hard to see how much more they can appreciate, particularly relative to other sectors. So we'd rather wait for, you know, investment grade spreads to get cheaper. And as they cheapen, we'll start to probably either add gradually, or if we see a big market opportunity, you know, a lot of volatility, you know, that may be when we add more extensively. And, you know, as a bond investor, it's really important, you know, to prepare for that. And so we have to make sure we're staying pretty liquid in our client portfolios. So within our taxable strategies, that means, you know, we've got a healthy allocation to U.S. treasuries and agency mortgage-backed securities. And then in our muni account, we have a good allocation to state and local general obligation or GO bonds. You know, I think given overall yields, right, being attractive, you know, we can afford to be patient. We're okay sort of being paid to wait. And again, when we see a bigger opportunity, that's when we'll take advantage of it. You know, certainly as a bond manager, you know, the other metric we think about is our overall duration, which, you know, really is just a measure of, you know, how much a move in rates is going to impact our portfolio. Now, we don't make big rate bets. That's just not a part of our philosophy or process. But typically, you know, we will add a small amount of duration if we think rates are going to fall at some point. And so in today's environment, you know, we're leaning slightly longer than our benchmark, just given our base case. Case, right, that the Fed is done hiking and is ready to move to cut when they get that conviction in the inflation trajectory. You know, we've also been targeting the more intermediate parts of the yield curve that we expect is going to benefit, right, from the curve eventually disinverting and moving to a more normal shape. You know, no guarantees on that timing, but we think that curve shift is more a question of when, not if.
That's great. Thanks for that insight. That's super helpful. Hannah, kind of the same question to you. What areas of opportunity do you and your team see in this current environment?
Yeah, so similar to what Christine highlighted, if we sort of take all that we've discussed thus far into account, while we do believe the outlook for global growth remains favorable, we don't believe that late cycle is a time to be making big bets in client portfolios. And so as a result, you'll see that our total return portfolios have asset class exposures that are relatively close to benchmark. We do have a modest tilt towards stocks with a slight bias to non-US stocks. And why is that? Well, a contributing factor is that despite an uptick in valuations across the globe in recent months, if we look at the trailing 1 year price to earnings ratio for both emerging markets and developed non-US markets, they both look a little bit more favorable relative to US stock valuations. And we also continue to emphasize core research strategies, which really focus on bottom-up stock selection. This approach has been beneficial as we've seen a broadening out of market participation, right? So last year it was all about AI, and it sort of felt like if you just said AI, stocks went up, right? In 2024, we've seen a widening out of market participation. And what do I mean by that, right? It's not just the AI theme. We've seen the likes of financials and utilities also doing well. We've also maintained some exposure to commodities. They can help further diversify portfolios should volatility increase, or can also help hedge against inflation surprises. And, you know, if you sort of think about all of this all rolled up, you know, it may sound a little bit boring, but it's our belief that following a disciplined investment process, like the business cycle, which we touched on, and focusing on news over noise, right, using facts and data, and that will help us make the most prudent investment decisions on behalf of our clients.
No problem with boring, at least from where I sit. So thank you for that. As we start to wrap up, we've got a few minutes left. I'd love to hit on some of the general themes that came in, again, from registrants who sent us questions when they registered. One of them, Chris, I think would be great for you. A lot of people are asking about the wisdom behind sticking with a 60-40 portfolio construction. That was sort of the gold standard for many people, 60% stocks, 40% bonds. Is that still a good way to go about things today?
That's a great question. You know, for the majority of clients, I think it is. I think back to what Hannah just said, the long game of a business cycle versus the short game. If you go too aggressive, right, 80, 90% stock, or, you know, shovel it all into technology because that's the winner right now, what's going to happen when that sector or, you know, stocks in general come down and you need to live off of that portfolio, or you've got a minimum distribution and the market's down? So for a 60-40, you're getting a little bit more growth than the overall market, but you're also getting 40% that's pretty safe and stable. Now, there's going to be outlier years, right? A few years ago when both stocks and bonds were down. But again, the long play, it evens itself out. So for the majority of clients that are either at retirement or into retirement, that's still a good, you know, baseline number. For some clients, they may feel comfortable with 70-30 or more, or a little bit less at 50-50, but 60-40 still feels like a good benchmark for the majority of clients out there.
Got it. Thanks for that. All right, we'll continue the lightning round right now. Hannah, back to you. You mentioned AI. Artificial intelligence actually came up quite a lot in our customer questions. What is Strategic Advisor's view on AI right now?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not surprised it came up. It's certainly been a year to remember for the AI theme. And that's really, honestly, it's been marked by both exuberance, right? Because the AI theme catalyzed a huge run up in the stock market, and maybe a little bit of fear too, that there would be sort of widespread and immediate job loss. So if we just think about sort of the two different pieces, right? Performance, first and foremost, I talked about a broadening out of performance across sectors, meaning more than just AI is contributing to market returns this year. And if we think about the Magnificent Seven, we're starting to see real winners and losers surface within that group, right? They're no longer moving in unison. And as it relates to some of the negative sentiment about AI, yes, we think there could be changes on the horizon to the way we live and work as a result of AI, but those implications and changes may take years, right? Think about electricity as an analog. It was patented in 1880. By 1920, 40 years later, only about 30% of US households were electrified. So we think AI could be similar, right? It's an evolution, not a revolution. And so there could be some real positives that come out of it: improved productivity, infrastructure spending, which could stimulate and support growth. But all of this really ties back, as Chris just highlighted in his response to 60-40, it all really ties back to the importance of a diversified portfolio, right? One that has the potential to capitalize on a variety of themes and outcomes.
Got it. And Christine, one for you as well. If you, I know this is going to be a big one, but it came up a lot. A lot of people asking about how to decide whether to invest in short-term, intermediate, or long maturity bonds. I know it's a very personal decision, but high level, how do you respond to questions like those?
Yeah, you're right, Jim. It is, you know, not a one size fits all, you know, answer. You know, everyone's going to have different time horizon or risk profile. So you got to keep that in mind. I think, you know, we talked about the risk and the advantage of the front end a lot, right? So, you know, right now you're getting a really nice yield, you know, yields in the 5% range. You know, they've been there just as the Fed has been on pause with their hiking cycle. So certainly attractive from that point. But again, the risk there is reinvestment, right? So it's really hard to call when the Fed is going to cut and by how much. And so, you know, you're at risk of potentially losing out on some of that yield if you continue to stay in the front end. If you go all the way to the other end of the spectrum and you talk about long bonds, right, that's where you're going to have the most price volatility, right? They have the most interest rate sensitivity. So that just means their longer duration or their longer maturity, right, means they may have bigger price swings from moves in rate. You know, just to put that in context, long treasuries are down just over 4% this year, while the broader fixed income market is down just 0.5%. So, you know, long treasuries might outperform if we get a big risk off event or, you know, we're getting a big rate cut. But again, you're just opening yourself up to more swings. So it's what you're most comfortable with. And then, of course, in the middle, you've got the intermediate part of the curve. You know, you may still benefit from some price appreciation as the Fed cuts, but likely less volatility than what you'd get at the longer end. You know, we typically think about intermediate strategies being more appropriate for, you know, investors that have a 3 to 5 year time horizon. So those are some of the considerations I think clients need to be thinking about as they want to pick their point on the curve.
One last question before we go. We're just about out of time. But at first, I want to say thank you so much for the perspective and the context and the breathtaking the three of you have allowed us to take today. Really, really, really important in times like these. So before we wrap up, I'd love it if each of you could just give our viewers just a couple, two, three takeaways that you would leave with as we wrap up.
Yeah, so I'll jump in and go first. You know, I think broadly, right, this still remains an attractive time for fixed income. When you think about the potential for things like income generation, capital preservation, and diversification, you know, and the second part is it may be time for clients just to evaluate, right, their positioning and their allocations as we think about the potential easing by the Fed later this year.
Hannah?
Yeah, I mean, as I think about the next few months, I would probably leave folks with that reminder that political rhetoric and news flow is going to get really intense over the short term. And in my sort of 20 plus years of investing, that noise can be really distracting. But just remember that markets rise and fall for all sorts of reasons, and we're going to continue to focus on variables and data like earnings and jobs and the consumer as we weigh the impacts on corporate profitability and global growth.
Great. And Chris, bring us home.
Yeah, you know, echo what Hannah said. Don't let the white noise cloud your judgment. I think I see a lot of folks, you know, trying to control things that they can't control. Control what you can control out there, which means reassess your plan as needs change. You know, treat your financial health or fiscal health just like your physical health. Reassess it constantly, but also ask for help when you need it. You know, reach out to us.
Excellent. Again, thank you all so much for taking time to be with us today. And thanks also to everybody who watched us and sent in questions as well. Just a reminder, for more timely market updates and insights on other financial planning topics, we'd love it if you wanted to subscribe to Insights from Fidelity Wealth Management. That'll get you exclusive invitations to future wealth management webinars, as well as access to our weekly newsletter. If you've got questions about anything we touched upon here today, please reach out to your Fidelity representative. Thank you for watching and have a great day.